This week in the news from Dorchester, we have some agencies on the move, some maneuvers by candidates, and a problem property that just won't go away. To fill us in is the news editor from the Dorchester Reporter, Jennifer Smith. Thank you very much, Jennifer.
Of course.
I want to talk about this story that seems like something out of the 1970s, the bad old days, the bleak house on Meeting House Hill. And a federal case. I mean, what's going on here?
Yeah, so for anyone that knows any neighborhood, there's always that one house that's kind of sagging, that's been in disrepair for a long time. And for the folks around Ronan Park, that means 97 Mount Ida Road, which has been a problem for them since before it was condemned in 2003. So fast forward 15 years later, and it's been damaged again because of a fire in 2011. And the city's been basically trying to get it either repaired or, as it stands now, razed, where they just say it's in too poor of a condition to really house anybody. But the owner has basically been playing musical chairs with the courts for all of these years to just slow down any change in ownership or any fixing up of the house, really. So he's batted it between housing court and federal court. Earlier this year, he even tried to make a case to the Supreme Court claiming that his right to own this house was somehow related to a conspiracy with the city trying to take away property from Black Bostonians. The owner is white, so that doesn't really make a lot of sense. But what just happened is it just went again to federal housing court, and the judge this time really has had enough. So he told the owner, James Dickey, you need to go back to housing court, and also we're putting an injunction against you trying to bring this back to federal court. Don't do it again without prior permission. So Inspectional Services is pretty hopeful that maybe this time in their next housing court hearing, they might actually be able to make some progress.
I know the neighbors want more curb appeal, but I'm sure there's more to it than that.
Oh yeah, I mean, this house has been something that I've been following for 2.5 years at the Reporter, but generations of previous Dorchester Reporter correspondents and reporters have handled this. Again, when the fire happened in 2011, it was in bad shape. Since then, it's actually now in such a state of disrepair that Inspectional Services and the fire department won't let their members actually go in. So if that house burns down, it's going to be dealt with on the outside. And if there's any problems for Inspectional Services, the most they'll do is board it up. So the concern basically is it's not going to fall down and damage anything on the remainder of the street, but it's basically a condemned house that's just been sitting around. It's ruining property values, and the concern as well is there are animals in there, rats in there.
You got my attention with the
rats.
I mean,
this is the thing that was so odd when I first started covering it, actually, is that apparently there's just piles of cat food in this house somewhere, and the question of whether or not the homeowner is actually breaking into his property to stay there at some times, and there are rats. So the neighbors I've been talking to for years are just, they've been at the end of their rope. They're just absolutely furious.
And making one more brief note here.
Yeah.
This is the same neighborhood that had another problem house. I think it's on the mend, but talk about that too.
Yeah, so last year there was a pretty bad fire on Marie Street at 8 Marie Street, where it was another three-decker that caught fire and ended up, and there had been issues with the landlord for a while, but it caught fire and actually damaged not only just the two three-deckers next door to it, but the heat was so intense that it melted the siding on the three houses behind it. So that is on the mend. The owner has been working with the city to repair it and bring it back up to a livable standard. But I've got to say, people saw that Marie Street fire and were immediately terrified that it was going to become another 97 Mount Ida.
A couple of things moving the neighborhood. One of them is a community center run by Boston Centers for Youth and Families. Talk about what's going to be happening with that.
Yeah, so the Cleveland Community Center is right by the Fields Corner T station, and it's going to actually be moving from that Charles Street location a few blocks away to Westville Ave. It's maybe a 5-minute drive or so, but they're moving into this facility that's part of the Up Academy Dorchester campus. And it actually used to be a BCYF, a Boston Centers of Youth and Families Center, before, and they moved out in 2012 or 13. So in a way, they're kind of making a return to this, the Marshall Center. And they say it's an advantage because it has a pool they can renovate and offer for the students to use. And the Cleveland Community Center is in fact going to be repurposed as swing space for the Boston Arts Academy for about 3 years, while their Fenway location gets a retool over the next few years.
One person's marketing can be another person's eyesore, and you get a couple of state reps trying to work on billboard control in Dorchester. Talk about that.
Yeah, anyone that's been around in Dorchester knows that billboards have been a point of contention for quite some time. A lot of them went up before there was really strict regulation on them in the neighborhood. So there is a policy from Dorchester civic groups collectively to oppose any conversions to digital billboards or constructing any new ones. But this is slightly different than that, where State Rep Dan Hunt, who represents that part of the neighborhood, is concerned because the MBTA has transferred over control of its billboard stock to a new company. And as part of the lawsuit that ended up moving it into control of this new company, they indicated that they were interested in seeing if there was the potential to digitize a lot of the standard, paper or trifold billboards that they had. And that made Dan Hunt and some other representatives a little bit nervous, because the MBTA doesn't have to go through local zoning processes if they want to actually make this change. They don't have to, say, go to a community group and say, if we want to convert this, we'll dedicate this much funding or this amount of the profits to your community group or local sports leagues, or in return will take down some other billboards. So the legislation that Rep Hunt is proposing right now, which was reported favorably out of committee at the end of last year, would basically say, even if the state owns these billboards, they will have to go through a normal zoning process as though they were just going up anywhere else in the neighborhood.
I know there's one great stretch where you've got the Red Line tracks and almost right next to it, the Southeast Expressway, lots of eyeballs for
yes.
billboards. So if this got out of hand, where would it be most likely to happen?
So the MBTA parcels, so I guess to clarify, a lot of the MBTA billboards are along pretty prominent stretches of 93, 95, so you probably drive by them every day, notice them, move on. But the concern, again, is if these things turn into big digital billboards, yes, it has the opportunity to be a great source of revenue for the T, which is cash-strapped right now. But again, one thing that the neighbors say, one thing that Rep Hunt says, is they're not opposed to the idea of digitizing billboards and they're not opposed to the revenue that they could bring in. The worry is just that it would happen without any kind of concrete community benefit or offsetting of a bunch of the paper billboards that are already up.
We got just a little time for the politics because there's some new candidates and a forum coming up. Talk about that.
Yes. So as usual, the roulette wheel of the local races continues. This year or this week, we have a change in the 5th Suffolk District, where there is an Elizabeth Miranda, who's recently pulled papers, joining Darren Howell, who's a political organizer with one of the local unions. And also, interestingly, since last time, Althea Garrison has decided that not only is she going to continue running for the 1st Suffolk to fulfill the end of the term, again, the primary for that, for everyone who's watching, is on Tuesday. So that's going to be Nick Collins is the lone Democrat. But in the May 1st election, Althea Garrison says she is still running for the 1st Suffolk, but wants to make a switch to again run in the fall for the 5th Suffolk seat that she held in the 1990s. And the last new name is in the DA's race, where Alinda Champion is joining the field as the 5th Democrat seeking that post.
Plus, the reporter's hosting a town hall with
yes,
Senator Warren?
We are. So next week on Thursday, April 8th, we're going to be hosting a public town hall, free attendance, registrations on site at the Boston Teachers Union with Elizabeth Warren, who, of course, is running for re-election
and
this
finally,
year.
To follow the news or Jen Smith, where should people go?
Either to dotnews.com, or you can follow us on Twitter at dotnews, or me at jen.smith.
Thank you very much for being with us.
Of course. Thanks, Chris.
Jennifer Smith from the Dorchester Reporter.